people question the law based on that. This is not from the Ahlul Bayt. Why should we recite it? And actually, it has problems. I want to say this. When it comes to requesting the law, not learning the deep aspects of our religion, the law doesn't have to be from the Ahlul Bayt, actually. There's an interesting hadith in Al-Kahfi where an imam quotes a layman a dua. He says this guy spoke to God, a shepherd, spoke to God in this way. I think remember the gist of it. It was along the line that he said, "Oh God, I know I have done wrong, but I don't have anyone to ask for forgiveness from except for you. Please forgive me." The imam quotes the wording and says, because of this wording, this person was forgiven. The way he asked, he was forgiven. And the imam is suggesting to you the wording of a dua alayna has asked. It doesn't have to be the wording of the ayah. We said this last night. Use your own language. Speak to God in your own language. Dua tawassul, even if, because this is a debate, there's a difference of opinion what the source of this is. Some believe that it's from the Ahlul Bayt, others believe it's not. Even if it's not, it's a dua that is legitimate. We are requesting the shafa'ah of the Ahlul Bayt, which is a fact of our faith mentioned in the Holy Quran and in plenty of the hadith, which is definitely followed. But for the du'as that we want to learn from, we've got to check the reliability. The du'a that I selected to try to learn a little from this whole time, the sessions that we have with one another, is du'a to God. Du'a that according to the hadith has got to or should be decided. We should do this du'a every night. I got interested because, you know, we're always reciting this, but I never checked the source for it. My checker was amazing. It's one of the few du'as that has a solid, unquestionable chain of narratives. So this is 100% from the other day. I want to talk about this a little bit tonight and continue the following night, inshallah. Recite it, inshallah. This dua, again, the language of is very special. When we want to do this dua, we have to learn of the touchiness that exists in this dua, the personal type of relationship that we're taught in this dua to have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Understand that. So when we say these words, we actually feel that personal touch to it. That's a very important part. The dua has a few different stages. The beginning phrases, as we all know, it starts like this. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma inni astaghfiruka wa astana'a bihamdik. وَأَنْتَ مُسَدِّدٌ لِلْسَّوَابِ بِمَنِّكَ. This passage, I'm not going to read the whole passage, the whole this section of it all the way to the end. It ends, this section of it ends with where the Imam says, addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَحَلْفَكِ بَلَاءٍ قَدْ فَكَكْتَهَا وَقَدْ فَكَكْتَهَا. The first passage of this dua gives us the general understanding of this dua that we find it in or throughout the dua. It says, in translated verse, O Allah, I open my thana. Thana is when you try to describe someone or something, that's called thana. It's been translated as praise as well. That doesn't seem to be an accurate translation. When you describe someone, whether it's in a good way or in a bad way, that's called thana. says, "Oh Allah, I open and begin my description of you, the Hamdulillah." The first thing that we have in addressing Allah to request for things from Him is reminding ourselves or learning about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Imam is describing Allah. We are trying to learn that description. The first thing Imam said is أَحْتَفُ الْأَنَاءَ بِحَمْدِهِ. The concept of hamd is something that I think we're all familiar with. The Surah Al-Fatiha, the opening, you can see a resemblance there between the Surah and opening. The opening of the Holy Quran also begins with this. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. We're supposed to recite the Surah at least, how many times a day? Five times a day? Ten times a day, right? Ten times a day, at the very least, we've got to recite this Surah. When we look at the prayer, we see the concept of hamd repeated other than this as well. When you go to the book, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, or behind you, you stand up, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدًا. You go to sujood, سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَ الْأَعْلَىٰ رَبِّ حَمِدًا. If تَشَهُدْ is مُسْتَحَبْ, you say, أَلْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ, or you say, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. In تَسْبِحَاتْ أَرْبَعَ, in the third and fourth rak'ah, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. The concept of hamd, praise, is repeated. It's very important that this dua begins with it. Some of the duas don't begin with the word hamd, but they begin by practicing hamd, praising. You are the Lord that has done this or has done that. And this dua actually gets involved with that as well. After this first passage, the passage is also Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah alladhi lam yattakhidh sahibatan wa la waladan. Alhamdulillah alladhi such and such. We see this repeatedly. One of the things, I want to give a deeper understanding of this hamd and why we're supposed to say this. The concept of hamd, according to hadith, okay, is the best way to thank. Let me stress a little bit on being thankful first, then we'll get to that. There's a hadith, it's interesting. It says, مَكْتُوبٌ فِي التَّوْرَةِ. We have a number of ahadith that quotes the previous divine books, sometimes the Torah, sometimes the Zabur. We have quotations from the Prophet Dawud ala nabiyyina wa alihi wa alayhi salam. We have quotations from Prophet Musa, we have quotations from Prophet Jesus, and others as well. This one is quoting a Torah. It says, اشكر من أنعم عليك وأنعم على من شكرك. Whoever gives you a blessing, whoever. اشكر على من أنعم عليك. Whoever gives you a blessing, be thankful to them. And whoever thanks you, bless them with something. I don't want to get involved with this too much. This is a divine trick. This is a divine trick that when we do something, he thanks us. What his thank is, I want to explain right now. And when we thank him, he gives us more. We'll have more of that, inshallah, if we get time. He, in the Torah, says, have this divine trait. Whenever someone, whoever may be, gives you a lesson you thank before, this is something we miss out a lot. Some of us have what is termed as the trait of a house fly. You know, the flies, if they try to sit on house flies, they don't sit on goods, they don't sit on flowers, they're not like, you know, butterflies. They sit on dirty things. All of everything that's around, if you have an infection, they'll be sitting on that infection. If there's any rotten thing around, you'll find it there. It'll be buzzing around over there. When you go to dirty streets and dirty cities, I'm sure you've been to some, if you've been to the East, the dirtier they are, the more bugs you see, the more flies you see flying around. You don't see them in a garden of flowers. You see them when there's filth. Okay. They're always chewing something ugly they go sit on. Some of us have this type of an attitude towards them. No matter what people do to us, we always see something negative. Instead of seeing the positive and being thankful for it, we're always seeing the negative. Always nagging. They bring us food. Yeah, they could have done a better job than this. This is not good for them. I mean, come on. They probably gave us the trashiest food they could have. When somebody, I mean, in Iran especially, we experience this a whole lot. There are problems in government offices when you go and you want to get something done. Right? It takes time. Those who've been there have been testified to this. You want something done there, I'm sure all of them.